There was a junior manager, a senior manager, and their boss that were together and they were going out to lunch. And so to get to the restaurant, they hailed a cab and were on their way. And while they were in the cab, they found a lamp. And they rubbed the lamp, and a genie came out of the lamp. And the genie told them that they could each have one wish. Well, the senior manager spoke up first, and he said, "I want to be on the fastest boat to the Bahamas with no worries." Poof, he was gone. Then the junior manager, he couldn't contain his excitement. And he says, I just want to go, take me to Miami. I want to go to Miami. I want to go to a resort. I want to be at an exclusive resort with great food and great drinks and beautiful women." And poof, he was gone. Now finally, it was their boss's turn to give his wish. He turned to the genie and he said, stated emphatically, "I want those two idiots back in the office after lunch." Now, you gotta be careful for what you want, right? So if you have somebody asking you what's most important in your life, what is it? What is our heart's desire? Let's go back to the first reading. The Lord said to Solomon in the first reading, "Ask something of me, and I will give it to you." Okay, he prayed, and he came up with, he wanted an understanding heart, because he was young. He was the king of a large country, and he prayed that he would be able to reign in his kingdom well, and for all the gifts that he could ask for. He asked for the wisdom to judge and to distinguish well right from wrong. And we know that Solomon is known for his wisdom. But eventually, you know, we know what happens, that, you know, those that followed Solomon eventually didn't use wisdom to listen to God in building up the kingdom. And eventually things like decadence, moral decay, massive spending became the decline of Israel that would lead to their defeat and subjection to one or more powerful nations. Now Jesus came to restore and to redeem God's people and to inaugurate this kingdom of God and to teach us the way of discipleship. That's what he's been doing for the last, what, 4 or 5 Sundays in a row, teaching us about that and speaking in parables to do so. And so he continues to do so again today. Now it's interesting, before I begin, that the British writer C.S. Lewis titled his only biographical work, Surprised by Joy. Now the title of that book was a tribute to his wife, you know, Joy Gresham, who was a confirmed bachelor most of his life, married in 1956 when he was 58 years old. And the reason that I bring this up is because both of the men in today's gospel parables were surprised by joy. They were surprised by joy in this way, the man discovering the buried treasure and the merchant finding the pearl of great price were very much alike, because they were surprised by joy. But in other respects, these men were quite different. Let's just take a look at the two men. The first man is a day laborer. He is plowing his employer's field. And one day, his plow catches on what it first thinks to be a rock. But investigation shows that it's not a rock. It is a pottery jar that is filled with gold and silver coins. And he realizes that this unexpected find can change his life, giving him the first financial security that he has ever known. But he also realizes he has a problem. And the problem is that the law of the day said, for example, buried treasure would belong to the person on whose property it was found. If something was on a property, it belonged to the person who owned that property. So rather than risking somehow getting into trouble, and carrying off the treasure at once, what does he do? He carefully buries the jar again. He finishes his day's work. And then later, he goes and he makes his employer, an offer to buy the field. And when this offer is accepted, this man is overjoyed. Now, the purchase of this field cost this man everything that he had. But that treasure was now his, and that treasure was worth far more. So we have the second parable. The merchant is different, because the merchant is looking for treasure. This is what he's out to seek. Years of buying and selling has sharpened his eye and has refined his taste. And one day he's walking through this bazaar and he sees a pearl so large, so flawless, that it takes his breath away. And buying it means that he would have to sacrifice everything that he owns, but it doesn't matter. Because when you found perfection, no price is too high to pay. God's kingdom is like that. That's what Jesus tells us in the gospel. Neither of these two men think for a moment of the sacrifice that they're making. What are they both thinking? They both are only thinking of the joy that comes from the new possession they have. Must we pay a price to be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ? You bet we do. Of course is the answer. And sometimes that price is very high. But if we only think of discipleship, if we only think of our faith, if we only think of religion in terms of what we have to sacrifice, what we have to do, doesn't it make our faith or our religion grim and forbidding? In these two parables, Jesus is emphasizing not the cost, but the infinitely greater reward. Now, I could talk about a whole great chorus of Christian disciples over the last 2,000 years who, like these two men in the story, have also been surprised by joy in their life when it comes to discipleship. But I'm just going to quote one. And today I want to talk about St. Augustine. You know, all through his 20s, this intellectually brilliant Augustine was searching for the highest philosophical truth. And he found it. No questions asked. He found the highest philosophical truth in Christianity. And he wanted to be a Christian, but he didn't want to give up what it would cost. He didn't want to give up his life of indulgence in order to do so. And it was only after God granted him the grace of conversion that Augustine wrote that what he had sacrificed for Jesus Christ was nothing compared to what the treasure he gained. Here's a quote from St. Augustine. "How sweet did it become to me all at once to be without those trifles." He talks about this in his Confessions. "What I previously feared to lose, it was now a joy to be without. For you cast them away from me, you true and highest sweetness. You cast them out, and you entered in yourself, sweeter than all pleasure." As followers of Jesus, we know that discipleship has its cost, but we also know that the cost is nothing compared to the joy that it will bring.